Second Peter chapter 3. Second Peter chapter 3. Peter, I'm putting your notes down here, okay? Okay. Gotta have a blank slate in front of me. Second Peter chapter 3. Last week, we talked about, for a while, for the last couple of weeks, 2 weeks ago, we talked about false teachers and the anatomy of a false teacher as put forth in 2 Peter chapter 2. And then last week, we answered some questions about those false teachers, and we asked some general questions. You know, are they going to get away with it? How long am I going to have to put up with it? What's going to happen to them? And we talked about the fact that 2 Peter gives us many terms that talk about a day that's coming that's still yet future. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, we find that they were reserved for judgment. Chapter 2, verse 9, the day of judgment is what it's called there. The day of the Lord, chapter 3, verse 10, it's also called the day of God, chapter 3, verse 12. And so we looked at these different names, and we concluded with the assessment that there is going to come a day that those false teachers are going to have to go in judgment. And that destruction is going to be the ultimate end of them. And then that the righteous are going to be delivered. Remember, we talked about Noah. We talked about Lot. And he says also in chapter 2 and verse 9 that he knows how to deliver you and me. Right? And so the righteous are going to be delivered. The unrighteous are going to face punishment. And I mentioned to you last week that we're going to use that as a segue to jump into a study about the final day, about the day of judgment, about the end of time. And I want us to do that over the next few weeks. I don't have a time frame set on it, and quite honestly, I don't want to restrict myself to a time frame, because the more I study each week, the more I'm finding I'm connecting dots and my study's going on, and I want to take you along on that study with me so that we can all have a better picture of this final day and be prepared for the final day. And so we'll take a look today at 2 Peter chapter 3, and we'll dive through that. Now, I want to lay down some ground rules, if you will, as we begin this study. First of all, this study of final things or last things, eschatology, we'll talk about that in a moment, is going to benefit you the most if you take notes, okay? If you don't take notes, you're not going to get as much out of this as you would otherwise. And so maybe you didn't come prepared to take notes today. I'm glad that this is being recorded. You can go back and watch it. You can pause it on your computer, and you can take some notes. And what I'm going to do, what I plan on doing for my own personal study, is what I want to suggest that you do as well. And that is, I'm taking a piece of paper, and as I go through these passages that deal with final things, I'm writing down different things like who, what, when, where, and why, those questions that are often so useful for us as we try to understand things. And so this week on Tuesday, when I put out the article on Tuesday that comes through the email, I'll put together a brief chart or a brief list of things that I've discovered about 2 Peter chapter 3. And then maybe you can take that and you can add to it. Or if you didn't take notes today and you want to take notes, you can use that as a place, as a foundation to do that. But the reason I want us to do that is because when we talk about final things, when we talk about the last day, really we can encompass so much of the scriptures that it can be fragmented if we only take one piece of it out. And it can leave us with a lot of questions. And let me tell you this, even when we get done with this study, you will still have questions that the scriptures don't answer. God just doesn't tell us some things. And we want to have this great picture. What is it going to be like, right? We talk about heaven, and we'll talk about hell. The Bible's very descriptive about hell. Heaven, we get some glimpses into it, but not near as much, right, as we do about hell. And so what I want us to do with our notes is I want us to be able to put down all these passages together and then try to form a somewhat of a cohesive picture right, of what the final day is going to look like and what we can expect in the life after this one, or if you're outside of Christ, the death after this one. The Bible calls it the second death. And so we'll write down all these terms. Now, also in laying down these ground rules, there's something that I want you to write across the top of your paper. And I want it to be very clear to you as we go through these things. And it's good that this is on video so you can go back and you can hear my words clearly. You know, I used to have a teacher when I was in preacher training school, and he would say this, "Don't quote me from your notes." And I thought, that's stinking rude. You're my teacher. I should be able to quote you from my notes. But here's what I've discovered over the years, right? Is that just because I wrote it in my notes doesn't mean he said it that way, nor did it mean he intended it that way. I have preached, I don't know how many sermons, where I've gone to the back afterwards to greet people on the way out, and they would say to me, you know, "I'm glad you said this," when I know I didn't say that at all. You did not hear what I was trying to get across. Now, my wife would say that's normal. We have that conversation a lot. Right? But that's husband and wife. That's a whole different thing. And I'm just kidding there. But what I want to get across is this. What I want you to hear is this. Okay? This study of final things, of eschatology, the academic world calls it eschatology, or theological world calls it eschatology. It's nothing more than a big word that says we talk about final things. I want you to hear this. Okay? And you've heard me say this similar before, but I want to get it on record as we go. Number one, the Bible does not teach and will not uphold any form of the doctrine known as premillennialism. Okay? When we talk about premillennialism, I know that there are those here who are maybe new to religion in general, or maybe you've been tossed about to and fro in different religious groups. Let me say this, and I'll do it in a nutshell. I'm not going to spend my time talking about premillennialism this morning, but I'm going to give it to you in a nutshell. This is what premillennialism says, okay? Premillennialism says that Jesus came to earth, right? To be king, to rule upon a physical throne of David. And while he was here, the people he came to, the Jews, rejected him. And as a result of his rejection, they put him on the cross. And as a plan B, okay, a plan B, the church was started. Right? And that plan B is going to continue. And then one day, Jesus is going to come back to a physical earth. He's going to rule on David's physical throne in physical Jerusalem and reign there for 1,000 years. And then there's a whole lot of other stuff that goes along with it. That's it in a nutshell. I want to tell you this. The scriptures will not uphold that view. Okay? Number one, as we've pointed out before, God's plan for redeeming man was in place before the world came, okay? Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 10. Number two, the church was not a plan B. The church was the plan, is the plan, okay? It was God's plan to have Christ be the head of the church from the beginning. No plan B. Number three, there will be, while we'll talk about some language, it can be tricky. There's not going to be a physical earth at the end of time. Okay, we're going to look at some language here in 2 Peter chapter 3 that can be challenging, but I want you to understand we're not talking about a physical earth. Jesus is not going to come back to a physical earth and rule on a physical throne. This will not uphold it. Okay? So, are we clear that Sean's not teaching any form of premillennialism? I need some head shaking here. I want you to know that you hear me. Okay? Number two. I know that generally speaking, I try to stay away, as I did. I did much so in my younger preaching time, but I don't find it as productive as I thought it was then. And stay away from trying to call names, if you will. But it's important for me to point this out from the get-go, that in the religious world, the Jehovah's Witnesses teach that this earth is going to be physical, okay? And that there's going to be physical world where people will physically exist. There's certain numbers of physical people that will be here. We're in no way teaching anything like that. All right? I want to get that, I want to make that clear to you as we go through this study. And the reason is because what you'll find is this. And I found this with us as brethren, and I'll say me too, I'm including me in this. Now, a lot of times when you see these erroneous doctrines, okay, when they teach erroneous things, they use biblical language. We're going to look at a phrase here in a little bit, a new heavens and a new earth. That's biblical language. That's what Peter wrote. So how do we understand what that is, right? A lot of times what we do is we want to run from that passage because they'll use that same language and we don't really know what to do with it, but we don't want to be thought of as premillennial. We don't want to be thought of in the same line as a Jehovah's Witnesses, so we sort of run from it, right? And sometimes we don't come to the right conclusions because of that. Now, what I want us to do is let's just see what the book says and let's write it down and try to get a picture. That's it. Let's try to be honest with the scriptures. Now, let's pull off glasses that we have put on, right? Sometimes we put on these glasses and we see the scripture through those filters. And sometimes it blinds us to what's being said here. So what I'm saying is, let's try to take an honest look at what it says. And let's get a picture of it, okay? All right. So today, we want to look at 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And we'll pick this text apart and see what we learn about this final day from 2 Peter chapter 3. So in chapter 3, he says, "This beloved, the second letter I'm writing to you, in which I'm stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder, that you should remember the words spoken beforehand by the holy prophets, the commandment of the Lord and Savior spoken by your apostles." Okay, well, what did they speak about? The next section you may even have in your Bible, a heading over it, the coming of the day of the Lord, right? So we know where he's going. We know what he's talking about here. Notice, first of all, that in the last days, we talked about the last days last week, if you weren't here, understand the last days is a phrase that doesn't talk about a few days, but a period of time, okay? And from Acts chapter 2 and other places, we recognize that last days began at Pentecost. They continue till now, and they will continue until the end of time. When is that going to be? You'll find out that we have no idea. Okay? We don't know when the end is coming. All right? But in the last day, these mockers will come after their mocking, following after their own lust. And this is what these mockers are saying. Verse 4. Where's the promise of his coming? Now, if you're taking notes, I would encourage you to circle that word promise and his coming, okay? Because you're going to see this throughout the chapter. So circle promise, underline his coming. For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation. For when they maintain this, it escapes their notice. Now, I want you to notice this. They're saying all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation. Now, if we stopped right there, you may not know what he has reference to. Okay? But what he says in verses 5 and 6 shows us where they're going. Now, where they're going is that they're saying there was no flood. Okay? That the flood didn't take place. We've given this a name. I doubt that they used this name in the first century. But uniformitarianism is what it's called. That is, that the earth began, there was no flood. Okay? And it just continues as it goes. That's what they believed. That's what they're saying. And they're mocking, right? Saying, just like there was no flood, there ain't going to be no coming either. So, when they maintain this, verse 5, it escapes their notice. You might want to underline that phrase, escapes their notice. That by the word of God, the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by water, through which the world at that time was destroyed, being flooded with water. So, Peter says that by the word of God, the world was flooded. And it was, what's the word that he uses there in verse 6? The world at that time was what? Destroyed. Okay? The world was destroyed. All right. And how was it destroyed? It was flooded with water. Now, so, obviously the mockers don't have it right. God has it right. Let me ask you something. Are there people today that say that a worldwide flood never happened? Do you think think that you're in the minority believing that it did happen. We're in the minority, okay? If you say that there was a worldwide flood, people are going to call you crazy. All right? So, still happening in the last days. But, by his word, verse 7, the present heavens and earth, where is that? Is that what we're living with today? The earth that we have now? It is, right? The present heavens and earth are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. And so, where the world was going to be destroyed by water, where it was destroyed by water previously, is now reserved for destruction by what? Fire. Okay? So we're on the same page here. Now, this is why I told you to circle the phrase or underline it in verse 5, escapes their notice. He says this to the brethren, don't let this one fact escape your notice. You see? This escapes their notice, but don't let this escape your notice. Beloved, with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promises, some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. So, it escapes their notice. They choose to let it escape their notice that there was a flood. But don't let this escape your notice that just because they're mocking and saying, where is the promise of his coming? And because they're not seeing it and they're choosing not to believe that the end is coming near, you don't let this escape your notice that God's promise is just as good today as it was when he made it. Whenever he made it. That's the point. Right? 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. Now, or chapter 3 and verse 8. God's promise is just as clear today. It's interesting to me. Well, no, I better not go there. I get trailed off and get distracted. Okay, so the Lord is not slow about what? What does it say in verse 9? His promise. Now we got that word promise again tied in with verse 4. So what's the promise? What promise is he talking about? His coming, right? We need to understand that. As some count slowness. Now, here's what I want everyone to understand here at the end of verse 9. Over the next few weeks, when we're talking about judgment, and we're talking about, we will talk about hell and the eternality of hell, and we're going to talk about heaven and the eternality of heaven, both eternal, okay? I want each of us to understand that which one of those places we go to is our choice. Notice at the end of verse 9, he's not slow about his promise, okay? Like we count it. God's not on a time schedule like you and I are, okay? But he's patient toward who? What does it say? Toward you. Now, I'm taking that personal, okay? God's patient toward me. You should take that personal. God's patient toward you. Not wishing for what? Any to perish. Does that mean that there will be some who will perish? That's what it means. Does God want it that way? It's not what God wants, but there will be some who perish. That's your choice. That's my choice. Then I get another choice, though, right? It's not only bad. He's not willing that any should perish, but for all to come to what? To repentance. You see the choice here? You can either choose to perish, or you can choose to come to repentance, come to God. And so in all these things that we talk about, and let me tell you what, when we talk about hell, it's scary. And we'll describe it. Remember this in everything that we're talking about. It's your choice. You get to choose. Okay? So, the day of the Lord will come. That's a guarantee. And how's it going to come? It's going to come like a thief. Now, if you're taking notes, write down these passages. And if you miss them, I'll write them down and on the thing I'm going to send out on Tuesday. You might write down Matthew 24:42-44. And you might write down 1 Thessalonians 5:2-6. And I've added also in mine Revelation 22:7 and 1 Corinthians 15:52. What's the idea of coming like a thief? Well, Matthew's text really describes it for us, right? The thief doesn't drop you a postcard and say, I'm going to be in your neighborhood on the 15th. And if you don't mind leaving everything out, I'm going to come in and, you know, make the collection easy, put it on the, right? The thief doesn't work that way. the idea is he's coming unannounced, and you're not, and you won't know when he's coming. Okay. Now, in our study, we're going to go through Matthew chapter 24, and we'll hit that even more so. But just keep in mind, he's coming like a thief. And what's going to happen when he comes? The heavens, right, will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. So you notice that we've had heavens and earth back in verse 5. We have heavens and earth in verse 7. And we have heavens and earth in verse 10. That's important to keep track of. All right? So this heavens and earth are the present heavens and earth from verse 7 that are going to be destroyed. And how are they going to be destroyed? Well, I don't think it's this language is difficult to understand. With intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. You may have in your Bible where the earth and its works will be laid bare. We'll talk about that later. Since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? Now, so he's saying, it's going to be burned up. And since it's going to be burned up and destroyed this way, what kind of person should we be? How should we live? If we're going to choose the repentance, right, at the end of verse number 9, how should we conduct ourselves? How should we live during our time here on earth? He says in verse 12, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God. Now, generally speaking, when we talk about Judgment Day and the second coming of the Lord, rarely do we connect with it the idea of looking for it and hastening that day coming, right? We sort of push it away, and we don't think about wanting it to happen. But here, Peter makes it clear. Look for it. Hasten it. Yes, the Lord's long-suffering, and he'll come in his own time. But we, as children of God, we should look forward to that day. It's going to be a day of deliverance. It's going to be a day of great joy. And so look for it. Hasten it, you know. In the way that you live, in the way with your attitude. You might also circle the word looking there, because you're going to see it here in just a minute. Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God. Why? Because which the heavens will be destroyed by burning, and the elements will melt with intense heat. I'd circle that word heavens there, because we're keeping track of the earth and heavens here. But according to his promise, hey, there's that word again, his promise. I'd circle that. We're looking, circle that, new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Now, we see this language. We're looking for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Now, we've already established the fact that a new physical earth is not going to be something that we discuss here. The Bible doesn't uphold that. But what does this mean? What does it mean when he says a new heavens and a new earth? And when he says this is part of his promise, how am I supposed to understand this promise? And what promise? Well, if you were to go back through the pages of the New Testament and go all the way over to Matthew chapter 1 and verse 1, you're not going to find this language there. See, this is where we understand where we've got to tie ourselves to the Old Testament. You're never fully going, we are never fully going to understand the New Testament unless we do some digging here in the Old Testament. So where in the world do we find this language? Your Bible probably has a marker there or a reference there. It says Isaiah chapter 65. Isaiah 65, 17. Flip over there very quickly. And let's see what Isaiah the prophet has to say here. Verse 17. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things will not be remembered or come to mind. So that, does that sound like the same? Does to me. Look over chapter 66, also in verse 20, I think it's 22. They just stuck together here. Yeah, verse 22. For just as the new heavens and the new earth, which I make, will endure before me, declares the Lord, so your offspring and your name will endure. So how do we, this is a reference to it that Peter quotes in 2 Peter chapter 3. How do we connect these two, and how do we understand them? Well, first of all, I need to understand the context that they're given in the book of Isaiah, right? You remember in our class on grasping God's word, we need to understand the text in their town before we can ever get into our town. So what does it mean? In a nutshell, this is it. This is it. You remember Isaiah's prophesying to Judah and telling them to repent. Otherwise, you're going to go into captivity. Babylonian captivity, right? We've talked about that on Sunday nights forever. And so God, in all of his sending his prophets about the punishment that is going to come, with all those punishments, he always gives a glimmer of hope, doesn't he? He always says, this isn't going to be the end. There's a glimmer of hope. And that's the picture painted for the Jews here. Okay? Yeah, you're going to go into captivity. But guess what? There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. And later on, we're going to find this phrase, the new Jerusalem. All these things come into play here. And so we have a prophecy, like we do with many, where there's going to be an understanding for the present audience, the group that Isaiah was writing to. But there's also yet one that is yet future. And according to 2 Peter chapter 3, is still yet future, right? But the language comes from Isaiah. Now, there is one other place that we read about this new heavens and new earth in the New Testament, but it comes in the book of Revelation over at chapter 21. Now, it's important to understand that when you get to Revelation 21, judgment has already taken place. So this is after judgment, okay? And in chapter 21 and verse 1, and really understand this, I'm not going to give you a whole lot of insight here. I'm trying to point out where these passages come from. Okay, so take that note. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. Does that sound like what Peter was saying? That the earth is going to be destroyed and there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth? Same language, right? So we've got a picture of it in Isaiah. We have Peter saying, you know, this new heavens and new earth is coming. And then in Revelation 21, which is after the judgment, John sees it. Okay? This new heavens and new earth. Now, what is that going to look like? I can't tell you. I can give you some hints to it, and we'll talk about some of what the Bible says about that later on. But if you're looking for a physical picture and want to know the full answer to it, God doesn't give it to us. This is where we have to trust God, right? We're reading the language. We're trying to understand the language. We don't want to put anything into the text that isn't there. Okay? So we have this, we're looking for this new heavens and new earth. Now, interesting to me, in all my studies so far, and I'll be glad to change this if I need to later on, when I'm looking at new heavens and new earth, heaven here is described as the place where God is now. Earth is a place described where we are now. That both of those are going to be changed. Okay? What they look like, I don't know. I know this. I know the end goal is this, that God dwells with his people. That's where we're trying to go. Okay? And we'll see that picture as we go on. But write that down. New heavens, new earth. And in that place where they are, that's where righteousness is. And I know that's where we want to be. Therefore, beloved, since you look for these things, there's that word look, three different times, three different verses. Since you look for these things, that is a new heaven and a new earth, that's what we're looking for, and hastening for it. Be diligent. Now, you remember when we started this book, we talked about the idea of being diligent. Peter ends the book with being diligent. The idea is do your best. You got to do your dead level best to do this, okay? To be found by him in peace and spotless and blameless. Now, how do we do that? How can we be found that way? Again, it goes back to the beginning of the book, chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. Remember those Christian graces or virtues? That's how we're found to be in that way. We're going to live those things. We're going to do our best to live those things. So when that final day comes and the new heavens and earth are revealed to you and me, then we're going to be found spotless and blameless. And regard, notice verse 15, regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. If you didn't see the article I stuck in, I don't know when it was, last week, week before, about every, I don't even know what I called it, every sunrise or every day is a witness to the patience of God. This is where it came from. Verse 15, when the sun comes up, I recognize God, by his word, allowed the sun to come up and allowed you and I to have another chance to serve him and allowed the sinner another chance to repent. And so while we're looking for the final day, while we're hastening that day and we want it to come, understand that when it doesn't come, that God is being patient because he wants people to be saved. Right? That's the picture that we have here. And so regard the patience of the Lord as salvation. Now, this is where you can get into the weeds a little bit. We don't want to because our time will run out on us. Just as our beloved brother Paul. So he's talking about the Apostle Paul. According to the wisdom given to him, wrote to you, as also in all his letters, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand. Let me ask you, you ever read anything that Paul wrote that was difficult to understand? If Peter says it's hard to understand, it's hard to understand. And we're going to talk about some of those passages. Hard to understand. What's the untaught and unstable distort, as they do also the rest of the scriptures, to their own destruction. You therefore, beloved, as brethren, knowing this beforehand, or being forewarned, be on your guard, so that you're not carried away by the error of unprincipled men and fall from your own steadfastness. Now, when we see these two verses, I think this is especially the warning was given to them in the first century, and give you the same warning today, right? People will stand, men will stand, and they're going to teach on the subject of last things. He's specifically talking about Paul preaching about final things. And there will be men that will stand and they will teach you about final things that are error. They are untaught and unstable. And as he says in verse 17, unprincipled. So they may be taught, right? Taught wrong or learned wrong. Or like the false teacher he mentions in chapter 2, just wicked, but unprincipled men. Here's the warning. As I go through these texts, okay, and talk to you about final things, write them down. Double check. Now, my intention with you is to be truthful. I only want to preach this word. Because I know James 3:1 says that men who teach are going to be held to a higher standard. Judgment is going to be more harsh. I only want to do that. So my intention up front is to lead you in this book. But understand this, I can still make a mistake. So you better check it. You better write it down. Sean Hockdorf ain't perfect. I know you may have thought he was. He's not. Okay? So write these things down and check it. But the fact of the matter is that there have been people in your lifetime, and you've seen it, right, who have taught about last things, and they've taught error. You've seen the billboards before, right? When some knothead says, hey, the end of time's coming in 13 days and 4 hours or whatever. You've seen that, right? Well, that's one of these people right here. And people follow someone that says like that. Peter's saying, don't get tricked by that. Don't get pulled in by those untaught, unstable, unprincipled men. They're going to lead you astray. Okay? So what I'm saying is, check it and double check it. And don't be led astray. And so as we come down to the end, he says this, in order for that not to happen, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so growth is going to be imperative to avoid those types of individuals. Now as we close out this morning, I hope you've taken notes. I'm excited about this study because I've been doing so much digging this last week, and it's exciting to me. And I hope that you will be as well. So please take notes and try to learn. As we close this morning, I want to close with what I told you I was going to use, the verse that I was going to use through all these, and that is verse 11 from 2 Peter chapter 3. It says, all these things are to be destroyed in this way. What sort of people are you to be in holy conduct and godliness, right? But what kind of person are you right now? Are you seeking to be one of those that that the Lord says, or that Peter says, are you seeking repentance, or are you one that's going to perish? I hope that you're one who's seeking to do what the Lord says, because these things are certain, right? When God says it's for, there's a day of judgment that's reserved, it's there, it's going to happen, okay? And none of us here, we just don't get the free pass card. We're all up here before the judgment seat of Christ, right? To give an account of things done in our body. Paul says, whether they be good or whether they be evil. That's pretty straightforward language. Where do you stand in light of that? If you stand outside of Christ, I hope that you'll believe that he's the Son of God. Repent, confess, and put him on in baptism. And if those things don't make any sense to you, what I just said, stop one of us afterwards. We want to show you what this book says so you can obey this book, so you can be obedient to the God who sent this book. if you are a member of the body of Christ and need prayers, need encouragement, need help, we're here to help you. Dieter's going to lead us in a song of encouragement. If you'll make it known to us, either up front or afterwards, we'll be glad to pray or help you.